and we are running an experiment at this moment. If you turn your head, you will see on the screen behind there, you can look at it in the break, there is a blue, there is a yellow, and there is a red column. And they are from three different boxes with different contents of carbon dioxide. I will not tell which is which till the end of the talk. You can guess. Because I have made and Tor Eriksen, he is a teacher in a school in natural science, in a primary school. And Yngvar is a photographer. So they are not scientists like me, but they got the idea for this experiment, and I have helped them. And we have worked more than 2 years with this, because we wanted to do something very simple that could be done by schools. And you can do it at home in your basement if you have a few tools. You can see. But I have prepared an introduction which is related to what has been said earlier today, because we have talked about carbon dioxide and how it can heat the Earth and not heat the Earth. But I will say something more, which will be followed up by Professor Charvet later, that the carbon dioxide we have in the atmosphere is not from humans. Almost nothing comes from our fossil use of energy. Okay, next. Let's see, I will have to be here, I think. So this is from the English part of it. Sorry, I'm not speaking German. But this I found in the IPCC report. All the red, this is about the carbon dioxide cycle. I will not go into detail. It's just what this red is supposed to be produced by mankind. And there are some numbers up here, and they are in petagram carbon. They measure carbon instead of carbon dioxide, but it doesn't really matter. But what I will tell is that the numbers are not, sorry, we go back. This is about the red numbers tell about 29% seems to be anthropogenic, 29%, according to this. But why do they get that sort of number? It's because of the lifetime of carbon dioxide in the air. There is a formula that I found it in the IPCC 2007 report. It's called the burn formula, which says that 20% of what we emit will be in the atmosphere forever. That's why we have the red curve growing. But the blue curve shows if what has been measured is that the half-life is about 5.5 years from nuclear tests in the Novaya Zemlya area in the Cold War period. It could be measured because then you have radioactive carbon and you see how fast it disappeared from the air. They got 5.5 years, and that must be an upper limit because it comes back from the Earth, from the zone. So 5.5 years is a maximum, at least. But if you look at isotopes today, it's probably less than 4 years, they say. But then my friends, Professor Ole Humblum and Kjell Stordal, we made an investigation of what happens in 12 months from 1 year to the next. We take the average of 12 months of carbon dioxide and of temperature of the earth, of the ocean, which is the red here. And I think the ocean is the blue, and the land temperature is the red, and this carbon dioxide is the green. And you see, always we have the blue, the red, the green. Blue, the red, the green. So always when the sea temperature goes up, 11 months later, carbon dioxide goes up. So there is a lifetime maybe of months, not years, involved here. And that means it disappears very quickly from the air. And if we look at this curve, and Professor Charvet will come back to this. This is the yearly cycles of carbon dioxide. It's, It's very much in the early spring or in the winter because of leaves releasing carbon dioxide. But then it starts to grow and it sort of disappears. The plants eat it as their food. But from that yearly cycle, it could be as short as 8 months for the half or the half-life. So if it's very short, one can do a very simple experiment, which I will show you. But also this curve is very, we like that very much. This Professor Humlum's curve. Here is the carbon dioxide, and here is the temperature since 1959 when they started to measure at Mauna Kea. The temperature went down for 20 years about, and then it went up. Of course, it looks like it follows the carbon dioxide, and then more or less constant. So there is no obvious correlation all the time, only limited part of the time. But here is the very important point, and this I really want to challenge you to see if you agree with me. This is what is the emission of carbon dioxide from fossil fuel burning. It's about 20 to 30 gigatons. And it increased by 1% per year from 1990 to 2002. Then it suddenly changed to 4% per year. Yes. And this is from the Carbon Dioxide Information Analysis Center, so I suppose it's correct. Suddenly it's changed. So the yellow here is what has come extra since 2002. This is the extra part. And if you look at the CO2 in the atmosphere, we can also see that there is a more or less constant increase. But it doesn't change very much after 1992. Maybe there is a little more up here. Emission changed from 1% to 4%. So this factor of 300% increase in the increase hasn't showed up very much. Sorry. What can be a difference? If we continue this 1% line, we get a little bit extra here. Okay. So that's what is extra because of the extra emission, and we expand it in the end, and I get about 5 ppm here, 5 parts per million. If we had 1%, we would end up with 395. If we have, I take the highest point to be very conservative, almost 400. So that's a difference of 5. So this 5 is what we got extra in this 13 years. And if you know that this is 300%, you can calculate back and find out what is 100%, and that is 1.7. So the total then in 2013 is 6.7 out of 400, which is 1.3%. So today, I claim that we have only 1.3% anthropogenic CO2 in the atmosphere, and I challenge you to dispute this, which means that instead of the numbers that IPCC gives here, we should have 825 or 815 coming from the nature, 14 coming from anthropogenic, and they claim there's an uncertainty of 10 in here. So does it mean anything at all? So I think we can forget about CO2 driving, or our fossil fuel driving the CO2 amount. But the plants like it very much, and that we'll hear about later. So how much warming then from this little CO2? If you use IPCC 3 degrees climate sensitivity, we get 0.07 degrees. If we use from Herman Hardy, very nice paper that came last week, which has 0.6 as a climate sensitivity, we get 0.015, one hundredths of a degree. And the price for reduction of CO2 is calculated to be this amount during this century, to half this number, which is clearly absurd. So I think we have a good case. Okay, back to our experiments. We have done more than 2 years of experiments with carbon dioxide, but people have done this before. It was done already in the 1870s. There's a very interesting paper and lecture called Baker and Lecture 1871, which they have some kind of instrument here. Here is some hot air coming up, and then they have some gas coming up in front of it. And they said that air, oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen didn't stop the heat. They measure heat with some device here, galvanometer that goes up if the heat comes one direction and or the other direction. But carbonic oxide, the carbonic acid, that is CO2, they stopped a little bit the heat. So they were heat-absorbing gases. The idea that the gases can do something with the heat, it goes all the time back to 1827, to Fourier, small paper here, that atmosphere can, gas can heat the ground. But it was really the Swedish Svante Arrhenius that came with the idea that the Earth is like a greenhouse. Same effect as in the greenhouse, that the gas, carbon dioxide and others acts as a roof in a greenhouse, and if we add more, it could be warmer or less, it could be colder. But there was a Professor Wood, he didn't like that idea. He did an experiment, and he has a very short paper. The idea was that the greenhouse acted as a radiation trap, he wrote. But in fact, I am of the opinion that the greenhouse made out of glass transparent to waves of every possible length would show a temperature nearly, if not quite, as high that observed in a glass house. So he didn't agree to that idea. And to find out, he built a small greenhouse. Black cardboard, one covered with a glass, the other with a plate of rock salt. Apparently that was very difficult to get something that transmitted heat, but rock salt does it. And he had a gift from the museum, British Museum, of such a plate, so he could do the experiment covered with salt. And there was scarcely a difference of 1 degree between the temperatures of the two enclosures. I do not pretend to have gone very deeply into the matter, and published this note merely to draw attention to the fact that trapped radiation appears to play but a very small part in the actual case, which we are familiar. And it took more than a year, apparently, more than 100 years. Somebody repeated his experiment that was done in 2011 in Mexico by Professor Nalle. And we have done this experiment this morning here, and we can verify. But there was a colleague who did it. Very simple, very simple experiment. He has a bottle, plastic bottle. He can have carbon dioxide in this bottle. He has a piece of paper here between some insulating sheets and a thermometer here. So we shines a lamp here through the bottle, and that heats the piece of paper, which is black, and you measure the temperature on that paper. So that's very easy. Are there any school pupils here? You can do that in your school. And then he fills the bottle with the carbon dioxide and repeats. And you measure the temperature with thermometer here. And next slide shows what he got. The upper one is when you have air, you have the blue, with the red is with carbon dioxide. So the paper behind the bottle doesn't heat as much when you have the carbon dioxide in the bottle. So carbon dioxide stops heat. He proves that part. stops it. But when he then measures temperature inside the bottle, there is no change. So what has happened here? The heat has been stopped, but the air inside the bottle is not warmer. How to explain this? I cannot, but we are experimenters. We can do experiments. What happened with the missing heat inside this bottle? Maybe it's a very little that you hardly can notice, but the two curves are on top of each other. Okay, here is his simple experiment. He has his bottle here. He has a sheet of paper inside the insulating material here. Styrofoam, I think it is in English. And there's a simple heater here. And thermometer measuring on the backside here, simple thermometer. So came Al Gore 10 years ago.
Certainty in the political arena.
Warming will actually save lives, not endanger them.
Do I believe scientists? No!
The fundamentals of climate change have been understood by scientists for decades. To start with, there are naturally occurring gases, such as carbon dioxide and methane in the Earth's atmosphere. In themselves, they aren't bad. In fact, we need them in limited quantities to keep our atmosphere at just the right temperature for life as we know it to exist on Earth. But if we produce an excess of these gases, as we have, the temperature rises, as it has. If you want, you can replicate this effect yourself in a simple lab experiment. Here's how. Take two identical bottles and set them side by side. Put a thermometer in each bottle and seal them. Then run a hose from a source of CO2 into one of the bottles. Shine two heat lamps of equal intensity at equal distance onto each one. Within minutes, you will see the temperature of the bottle with the carbon dioxide in it rising faster and higher. The bottles are like our atmosphere. The lamps are like our sun. Most of the solar radiation reaching the Earth is absorbed by the surface and atmosphere, which in turn radiates energy out toward space as infrared energy, heat. Most of the heat energy from the surface is then absorbed by the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere and radiated back down toward the surface. The more greenhouse gases we create, the more heat is absorbed and sent back toward the surface to cause further warming.
All the terrible things that happen because of global warming. But, and this has been seen by more than 6 million people, and they all believe that this is correct. But this is a fraud. This is completely wrong. And there is Anthony Watts, he has done the experiment with exactly the same equipment, and you can look at this address. Internet address. There was two thermometers, and one showed the temperature rise within minutes. It was warmer, like you see here. But these thermometers showing this were not inside the bottle. They're not inside the bottles, they are outside. And it's not two different thermometers, it's the same thermometer. Because they are handmade. And they all have a small flaw, something wrong. And here you see a black spot here before 98. And the same spot is here. It shouldn't be there because handmade thermometers are all different. So if you take the difference between the two, you see them nothing. It's the same thermometer except different temperature. So, and inside. And then Anthony Watts did the same experiment. He took care to find exactly the same devices. And he also, this temperature, this is photographed inside the bottle. And the one showed with the air showed 97.4 after 30 minutes. And the one with carbon dioxide showed 97.2 tenths of a Fahrenheit difference in 30 minutes. So they're not several degrees in a few minutes. And surprisingly, the carbon dioxide is a little bit colder, lower temperature than the one with the air. And of course, he could do it more properly with the recording device. And you see the two temperature curves. A, the blue one, and B, the red one with carbon dioxide. You see the blue one is always warmer than the red one. A little bit, few tenths. So what they actually do here is you looked at the two bottles, and there was a glass lid and infrared lamps, and infrared light doesn't go through glass. So it was not radiation measured inside. It was heated up, the lid of the bottle, it was heated up, became warm, of course. Then the heat transmitted inside. So what I measured was conductivity inside the gas, with which the air has 26 milliwatt per meter Kelvin, and carbon dioxide less. So it heats, conductivity is less in carbon dioxide, so it heats slower than air. So that was what happened in these bottles, but everybody then believed that due to carbon dioxide, it becomes warmer. Of course, you have had the lecture about what carbon dioxide and what really happens in the atmosphere with the different gases that absorb. Nice lecture this morning. But what happens then inside a greenhouse is that short wavelengths, they go through the glass. They heat the ground, the plants, whatever is in here. And some of them go out, long wavelengths go out through the glass. But infrared wavelengths, they are stopped by the glass and are not transmitted, of course. And that is what happens inside the greenhouse, except one thing that is very important, it stops air moving. You have warm air rises and heats the greenhouse, but it is not allowed to escape. So it's the air that is trapped inside, which heats the greenhouse mostly. And we wanted to repeat this experiment, but of course we didn't need to. Yngve, you have to come with a film, plastic film. We have today, everybody has this very plastic wrap film in their kitchen. And this is a very, very nice film because it transmits infrared wavelength all the way. The glass stops at about 2 or 3 microns. This transmits through the whole spectrum. So you don't need to have a big piece of rock salt today to do the experiment. Here we have one that is extra wide, and we can show it here. It's you have it at home. You wrap your food in it. It's transparent. So today is much easier to do that sort of experiment. Yeah. Yeah. But we got extra wide one for our experiments. And we went to the workshop in the school and made boxes. We made four of them. And here we have one with this plastic on top, plastic foil. Then we have a sensor. And then we have a computer that reads the sensor. That's all we have of equipment. But in addition, of course, we have a possibility to measure how much carbon dioxide we have inside. Unfortunately, it doesn't go further than 10,000 parts per million, but anyway, you can measure what it is in the room. So we built four of these because we wanted to be in a school environment and to do it in a school lecture hour, not to spend all night or week to do experiments. Here we calibrate the sensors, then we read out on the screen, and we have the same thing over here. In the beginning, we had wooden boxes like this, and we had lamps, halogen lamps. But we had to put up some walls in between, so the lamps should shine only in one of these boxes. And here is our first result, showing exactly what Wood also found. Here is a curve where we have no walls at all. Here we turn on the lamp. We get a few degrees warmer, no walls. Here we have with walls, but no roof. Here we have two different roofs. One with glass is the blue one. No, the red one, sorry. And the blue one is with the Gladpack, it's called. It's a plastic film. It heats up a little bit quicker because it transmits more than the glass. But of course, the glass stops radiation going up better than this emits the emission. So here the glass becomes warmer. But it's only 4 degrees difference here. So we prove that the greenhouse gets much warmer because it has walls and a roof. It's not because it stops infrared radiation. At least that effect is much smaller. We did that experiment this morning here too, so we have fresh data. I'll show you tomorrow. And here is an example where we added in one of the boxes 100% carbon dioxide, like the Al Gore experiment. We have also done that today. I can show you tomorrow the result. We won't show you now. And then finally we went outside to do it with the sun, but to do that in Norway or in northern Germany is not so easy. We had to wait all summer to get a clear day. But finally, I will show you results tomorrow. But to go here, we made a new version of it because we thought we have from the sun and from a lamp, we get radiation in, we get to heat the walls, and then the walls heat the air. But what we really want to measure is the air being heated. So we don't need the sun, we don't need black walls. We put in some heaters in the bottom instead. So we make it much simpler. And of course, if we have electric heater, we can know exactly how many joules, how many watts we have inside, how much heat we put inside. And then we can do calculations. That was finished only 2 days ago, so we haven't done much calculations, but we have brought it here and we have already demonstrated. Here is the example, a test setup we did on Tuesday. On Wednesday, we went on board the ship and came here yesterday. But it's working. And you can see the result down there. So here we have what we show here. We have a constant Hahn wire in the bottom that delivers is about 60 watts or something. Yeah. Inside acrylic walls. Because we wanted to have a wall that didn't diffuse any gases. We want to do experiments with different mixtures of gas to prove this, to check what really happens. Because we thought that if we have a wooden box, things happen with wood, and it's not so reliable. So that's what we have so far. And we are running experiment at this moment, and you see the first result on the wall, and I think you have a coffee break right now, so we can look at it. So conclusions so far. Our atmosphere contains less than 2% anthropogenic carbon dioxide. That's my impression. The atmospheric variations of carbon dioxide is determined to the first order by the temperature of the oceans. Oceans outgas when they heat up. And the Al Gore experiment is supposed to show that a bottle with carbon dioxide becomes warmer in a few minutes than one with the air. This is a hoax. This is completely false. The greenhouse hypothesis can be tested with boxes with the roof that is transparent for infrared radiation, this plastic wrap that we showed you. And you can build such a box at home and demonstrate for your family. We have built 3rd generation small boxes of different types and makes experiments with our 3rd generation. And we do it right now. And I can tell you now, we made a very advanced, more advanced experiment right now, because instead of 100% CO2, we make a redouble, to test the climate sensitivity. What is the temperature change by doubling? And you can see on the wall, the blue one has the minimum carbon dioxide. The green is about 4 times, and the red is 8 times. And you can see which is the highest. Thank you very much.